It's time for the first plenary talk of the day, and on behalf of the organizers, it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Roberto Trigiani from University of Memphis and University of Virginia, who will speak about boundary feedback stabilization of fluids in Bessel spaces of low regularity by means of finite dimensional controllers, 3D Navier-Stokes equations, and Goosenecke systems.
Well, thank you very much. Greetings to everyone, wherever you might be. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for the kind invitation that I was very pleased to accept. I myself much regret that I was not able to visit in person such gorgeous institution that is Chapman University and meet with colleagues and friends whom I've not seen for many, many years. Perhaps we shall take revenge next year. I would also like to express my greatest admiration to the organizer for putting together this huge conference with high caliber speaker, et cetera, except myself, obviously. Now, rather than rereading the title, the lengthy title here, let me try to dissect it in order to extract a main message out of it. So the key theme is stabilization. What does it mean? Means forcing stability on a dynamical system that originally is unstable. So you go from something bad to something good in terms of features. Stabilization of what? Stabilization of fluid, but more precisely, stabilization of the 3D Navier-Stokes equation by means of what? By controllers, which are given in a closed loop feedback form, are boundary based, and most importantly for this talk, they are finite dimensional. The finite dimensionality of this problem was an open problem for approximately 20 years, and I will give you the solution today. Once you solve the 3D Navier-Stokes equation, you can move on to the Goosenecke system, which is a system consisting of coupling a Navier-Stokes equation with a thermal equation. This talk was originally intended to be a 55 minutes of a 60 minutes talk that I gave at the MSRI at the end of May, the Mathematical Science and Research Institute at the University of California, Berkeley, during the semester, the spring semester called Mathematics of Fluids. However, here, very likely, I will not be able to talk about Goosenecke because since the conference is an operator theory rather than PDE, I will have to go a little more slowly. So the talk is essentially based on the following papers. One is the one on the archive Rational Mechanics, just appeared. It's a very lengthy paper with Irena Lascesca and our first PhD student from Memphis, Budica, who I think is in the audience. Hello, Budica. The second one is about Goosenecke. In this Journal of Universe and Ilpos problem, it's appeared already at least online, and some sort of supporting pillar for both problems and others is this paper on maximal LP regularity, which I will describe later on what it means, for an abstract evolution equation with application to closed loop boundary feedback, which is in the area of control. Before I start, let me give you some insight, some overview about, for instance, uniform stabilization is one of the cardinal topics of the theory of control, along with the controllability, optimal control, et cetera. And what is behind is that in the area of control, the controller is not a passive observer of an equation, rather is an active agent. They want to transform an equation from something bad to something good. In the present setting, we start with the dynamics, with the free dynamics, which is uncontrolled, therefore, which is unstable. Then we seek to apply a suitable control action, presumably or hopefully in a feedback form, which is the same way as a thermostat works, and I will explain mathematically what this means later, in such a way that the resulting new dynamics under the action of the control become stable. In the case of PDE, defining on a bounded domain, one preferably seeks to exercise minimally invasive control action, for instance, on the boundary, in fact, even on a small portion of the boundary, if it is possible. This is the most desirable physical, most desirable and attractive case, and if possible, and you will see when it's possible, when it's not, is also the mathematically most challenging. So let me give you some very quick historical perspective and some terminology. Boundary feedback stabilization of unstable classical parabolic equation, first linear, next nonlinear, defined on a general multidimensional bounded domain, was in fact intensively investigated in the period, say, 73-83. A general strategy was proposed, in fact, in my PhD thesis in Minnesota in 73, and is based on the following steps. I will give some qualitative insight. For sake of illustration, let me first concentrate on the linear, and later on I will talk about the nonlinear case. So in the linear case, let's write the PDE in an abstract form given here, where W is a space of Hilbert, Banach, whatever you want, and A is an operator of the free dynamics. In the case of parabolic problems, is going to be a generator of a strongly continuous analytic semigroup. B is an operator that, since I'm thinking about U being on the boundary, the operator B is a very bad operator. I don't want to say much about it. I want to be a bit vague because I want to concentrate on the operator A, and I want to give a sense of the strategy rather than the technicality about B. So if you start with initial condition in the space and you put U as a forcing term or open loop controller, then presumably you get a solution in a suitable functional setting. And what is the preliminary assumption that makes the problem of stabilization relevant? You look at the operator A, the free dynamics, so U equal to zero, and you start by a situation which is bad. Namely, this generator of the strongly continuous analytic semigroup, and therefore its compact resolvent, so the spectrum is just point spectrum, has a number of unstable eigenvalues. Let's call it lambda one, lambda n, and which are contained in this traditional characteristic triangular sector. And then in 73, the strategy was the following. Introduce a projection operator Pn, which is defined by this classical formula based on the resolvent, which on a curve, a simple curve, which embraces the n unstable eigenvalue. And then on the basis, so the Pn goes from the whole space into a finite dimensional subspace of dimension n. And then you project the space by Pn and by one minus Pn. And you get on the one side, WU stands for unstable, is finite dimensional. And the other one is stable. Why? Because for analytic semigroup, the space I minus Pn is defined in terms of the eigenvalues. They go from lambda n plus one to minus infinity. And for analytic semigroup, the location of the spectrum determines the decay. So this is stable. Then you restrict the operator on the two subspaces, W unstable and stable. And you look at the corresponding, you split the problem, the linearized problem, into two components. One W sub n corresponding to the finite dimensional unstable, and one zeta sub n corresponding to the finite infinite dimensional stable. So you want to study the finite dimensional stable part, which is defined on generalized eigenspace corresponding to the unstable, distinct unstable eigenvalues. Okay, so you apply this projection Pn, and the equation becomes given here. So W, the first derivative, AU, which is unstable finite dimensional. B, I wanted to be deliberately vague because an operator that describes the action from the boundary is very, very badly unbounded. And so let me call it B1, the Pn applied to B. And then you get the infinite dimensional component. What we want to do, following a technique that goes back to the control theory of the 60s, you have a problem here, which is defined in terms of two finite dimensional operators, A unstable and B1. And you want to stabilize. We want to stabilize the whole system, the infinite dimensional system, this PDE, And so you would better start by stabilizing the finite dimensional unstable component to begin with. So what we want to do, we want to find a static state feedback, which produces by feedback an arbitrary large decay rate, certainly bigger than the absolute value of the real part of the first stable eigenvalue. What does it mean? So this is a technique of the finite dimensional control theory of the 60s. Find a feedback finite dimensional operator F, F stands for feedback, such that if you define the input to be the feedback of the solution, the corresponding a closed loop system, so this is a closed loop system defined by this new operator here. What we want, if possible, is that F is such that will force this new closed loop system to be exponentially stable with an arbitrary large decay rho. So this picture gives an example, give an illustration of what it means closed loop feedback problem. To obtain such a property from F, you need a property, you know, which is called by some people is called complete stabilization. We go back to the again to the finite dimensional theory controlled many years ago, and you need to verify the so-called controllability finite rank, very famous controllability condition of Kalman, in order for this pair. Now, depending on where the control is located, whether it is an arbitrary small set of the interior, whether it is located on an arbitrary small set of the boundary, this condition of finding F such that this feedback problem is exponentially stable may be false. In fact, we're going to see some example very soon. And if true, may be very challenging to establish. The problem is not a matrix theory problem, by the way. You will see that it's a PDE problem. Ultimately, in fact, and it took some time, at least to me, to understand the correct way of doing these things, this ability to find such an F in the context of PDE here is the depending on a suitable overdetermined unique continuation property for an elliptic problem, namely for the adjoint eigen problem corresponding to the unstable eigenvalues. So for the operator AU star. And we shall see some illustration in a moment. Let me now say a few words about the history of the Navier-Stokes stabilization of Navier-Stokes. The problem of uniform stabilization of Navier-Stokes equation on a bounded domain was initiated by the pioneering work of Andrei Fursikov in Moscow with, in fact, four papers in the period 2001-2004. Every paper was in Hilbert setting according to the tendency of the trend of the time, first in dimension two, then in dimension three. However, his work was open loop boundary control, was not closed loop boundary control. Moreover, the approach technique that he used for his technique was not the question of whether the control was tangential or whether it was finite or unidimensional did not really enter the analysis of his approach. And his method did not really able to solve these questions. Fursikov's work was very important in spurring interest in stabilization problem both in Europe and in the US. So the first solution for the uniform stabilization Navier-Stokes in dimension, physical dimension two and three, with a finite dimensional control, was done in not in the boundary case, obviously, in something which is simpler, but still not trivial, when the control are localized on an arbitrary small subdomain, little omega of omega. And I want to show to you what is the Kalman algebraic condition in this case. Because if you don't verify the Kalman algebraic condition, so you cannot get started. It's like having a key of the car and the car doesn't get started. It's step zero, so it has to be resolved. And what is the Kalman algebraic condition in this case? So now the first mode will be, as I said, interior, not boundary for the time being, but interior control localizing this little omega. And the paper in questions, of course, in feedback form, finite dimension, et cetera. And the paper in question is this Indiana Journal paper of the 2004 with Balbu. The approach was, of course, Hilbert setting at the time was based on optimal control theory and corresponding Riccati operator. I will say something more about this in a second. This result was much improved, not only going from Hilbert to Besov, but also in terms of finding a very better, more manageable, more checkable algebraic conditions, et cetera, et cetera, in this paper here in AMO with Irena and Boudica. So I want to say now what was the, okay. So what is the, here it is. What is the algebraic condition? So let me start, therefore, for the first time by showing the Navier-Stokes equation, which is given here, uncontrolled, so there's no control action acting to it. This is a famous nonlinearity. Y is a velocity vector field, dimension, physical dimension 2 and 3. Pi is a pressure, a scalar pressure. Fe is the external force, and this constant here is the viscosity coefficient. Everything is uncontrolled for the time being. So zero boundary condition. Then the first starting point is for the problem stabilization to be relevant is to look at the steady state equilibrium solution. So you throw away the term corresponding to the time derivative, you look at the corresponding elliptic problem where the quantity now depends only on the space variable and is given by this term. So there is a sub E means equilibrium. Then you quote a standard theorem, which says that if you start with the datum Fe here in Q, then there exists a solution, generally non-unique, of equilibrium solution for Y, equilibrium solution for the pressure. The Y gains two derivatives, and the pressure gains one derivative modulo constant. Generally, the solution is not unique. It is unique some special cases where certain quantities are small. Now, for our case, you take up one of them, which is unstable, and you move with a particular one. So it's not an important, the lack of uniqueness is not important for us. What is the problem of stabilization and its physical importance? For Rayleigh numbers, one over this coefficient nu zero, sufficiently large, and for a given forcing term, it turns out that the steady state solution equilibrium solution becomes unstable. What does this mean? This means that the Ossian operator that corresponds to the linearized equation, which I will show later on, has n unstable eigenvalues according to the picture which I saw before, and therefore may cause turbulence. It is therefore important to be able to suppress such turbulence asymptotically in time by selecting suitable control action. And here it is. So we go back to the instability condition of the Ossian operator, which is a Stokes operator plus a perturbation. And so we have an unstable eigenvalue. So what we want to do, here's the goal. We want to introduce possibly in feedback form and possibly finite dimensional, minimally invasive control such that they stabilize the Navier-Stokes nonlinear equation in the vicinity of an unstable equilibrium solution. In fact, in the uniform exponential decay of the corresponding functional setting. The fact that the equilibrium solution is not unique, it doesn't matter. You select one which is unstable, you work with that. Okay, so here for the first time, I'm going to show now, not the boundary, but for the time being, I'm talking about the localized interior. So this is the Navier-Stokes in black. And in red is the control action, which is not in feedback form, it's just open loop. M is the characteristic function on this little omega in the interior. And so what is the general strategy for the stabilization of the full nonlinear Navier-Stokes in the vicinity of an equilibrium solution? You start with the linearized Ossian problem, and you seek, if possible, to produce a uniform stabilization. Since this is linearized, there will be a global. There will be a global uniformly, a strongly continuous semigroup, which in fact is going to be analytic. Parabolicity is preserved. And you want to do that, if it's possible, by obtaining a decay rate, which is as close as possible to the absolute value of the first eigenvalues on the left-hand side. If you succeeded to take care of the linearized problem in a global sense, then you use the same feedback control mechanism, which was successful on the left-hand side here. You put it on the fully nonlinear equation, and you hope for the best. Namely, you hope that at least in the local for the nonlinear and Navier-Stokes equation, at least locally, namely in the vicinity of the unstable equilibrium solution, this feedback, which was successful in the linearized version of the problem, is able to produce now local uniform stabilization. And to do the thing on the left-hand side, they use this technique which I described at the very beginning, going back to 73. What I want to show now is what is the Kalman controllability condition for this simpler problem, because the control is, yes, arbitrary localized, but in the interior. Because I want to show the relationship with this PDE, you know, in a continuation problem. So, and without that, you cannot get started with the problem. So, let me start, therefore, with the eigen. So, the script A here, sub Q, Q is the space LQ in which we are working, or we seek to work. So, this is the Ossian operator, so the linearized version of the, which I will show later on in detail. So, you look at the eigenfunction of the Ossian and the eigenfunction of the adjoint with the appropriate regularity. L sub sigma here, sigma stands for solenoidal. I will show in the next transparency that you have to, you know, this is standard for Navier-Stokes. You have to essentially project the problem into a solenoidal component in order to get rid of the pressure. So you start with an eigenvalue, which has a Li geometric multiplicity. So has a Li from one to Li eigenvector corresponding to this eigenvalue. And what is the Kalman condition for this interior problem? For the interior problem, the Kalman condition fortunately is satisfied and is given by this theorem, which was in this paper, you know, the 2004 in Indiana. It is possible to select vectors, what, U1, UK, in the solenoidal component of LQ, whose maximum value is optimal, in fact, is the maximum of the geometric multiplicity of the unstable eigenvalue, such that this matrix here is full rank for each I being unstable eigenvalue. And what are these elements here in the matrix? These are the adjoint, the eigenfunction, eigenvector of the adjoint problem localized on this little omega here. Now, how do you show that this is true? That I want to show the relationship with the PD. So suppose that we start with a situation where these vectors in the full omega are linearly independent, corresponding to the eigenvalue lambda I. What the big step here is to show that if these are linearly independent by selection, are linearly independent in the full omega, they remain linearly independent when omega is restricted to little omega. And how do you show that? Suppose by contradiction that this is not true, therefore they are linearly dependent, and therefore one, say the last one, is a linear combination of the preceding one in little omega. On the basis of this formula, define a function phi star, which is the difference of this thing, but in big omega. So this function, when specialized to little omega, becomes zero. On the other hand, is a linear combination of eigenvectors and therefore is an eigenvector. Therefore, this function phi star has the property to be an eigenvector of the adjoint problem given here, and in addition has the property to vanish on the little omega. The PDE version of this statement is to satisfy this eigen problem in a PDE form with the additional overdetermined condition the phi on the little omega is zero. And the key point here of the proof is to show that this overdetermined elliptic problem, eigen problem here, in fact, potentially eigen problem, produces a solution phi star, which is in fact a zero on the entire omega in the adjoint space. And therefore, you know, the last one is a linear combination of the preceding one in little omega, on big omega, and therefore it's a contradiction. To show this implication that this is certainly non-trivial, and I'm aware of a couple of proofs that we had a proof in this Indiana journal, which was based on starting from some result in Normander, et cetera. But I never liked the proof, frankly. And then I came up a few years later with an independent proof, which is give also stronger result, which is based on some, for those who know, it's called Kalman type of estimate for the Laplacian, which were derived by looking at the Kalman type estimate for second order hyperbolic or
Schrödinger operator and restricting to the Laplacian. So the proof is certainly non-trivial. As a result of that, therefore, at least for the interior, one can start with the problem. Now I want to start with the boundary. And in particular, I want to have an overview of what was the situation in the boundary case. So there were these four papers of Pulsikov in the early 2000. Everything in Hilbert setting, in fact, all the stabilization problems for parabolic were essentially in the Hilbert setting. Typically, how was the uniform stabilization of the linearized problem handled? Was handled by introducing an optimal control problem with a quadratic cost functional over time t equal infinity horizon, and by using the Riccati equation, which started with for finite dimensional with Kalman in the 60s, and we was generalizing some of their work, etc. You find that there is a unique optimal solution because this is strictly convex. And you can express this optimal solution in a feedback form by means of a Riccati operator, which is a solution of an infinite dimensional Riccati, second order Riccati algebraic equation by infinite dimensional. The result of this feedback solution here, so the optimal solution, not as an open loop, but as a closed loop, turns out to define a strongly continuous analytic semigroup. So the parabolicity is preserved, but in addition is an extra bonus. In addition to be unique solution, it is also the semigroup is uniformly stable under minimal assumption. So this procedure here of optimal control produces exactly uniform stabilization, in fact, in a feedback form like we want for the linearized problem. So this is a technique that was used many times for feedback stabilization of parabolic problem. This paper here is a paper, is a memoir of 120 pages or so, but there was an assumption, which I don't want to recall here, which had to be eliminated. Then there was some, you see very quickly, I cannot go to the whole literature, but it was recognized that in dimension three, the problem of finding finite dimensional feedback control was an issue. So some people tried to use an oblique control rather than tangential, which was in addition dynamic rather than static, sometimes was open loop rather than closed loop. So there was some issue that people were trying to go around. And now I can start talking about the uniform stabilization from the boundary. So I go back to the situation where the free operator is unstable. And as I said before, we want to find minimally invasive control on the boundary, in fact, typically boundary based, in particular to be finite dimensional, such that the resulting feedback problem be not only well posed in a certain functional setting, but also uniformly stable near in the vicinity of the equilibrium solution, which was unstable. First attempt. The first attempt is to take, we were unable to find to limit this gamma tilde. The gamma tilde is supposed to be arbitrarily small portion of the boundary. And we want to put a control which is tangential on this gamma tilde, arbitrarily small. A tangential control is actually, if you look in engineering books, is very preferred because it's implementable through jets of air. So we would like to see whether it's possible to select the minimally invasive control tangential and arbitrary small portion of the boundary. And of course, at the end of the game, we would like V to be expressed in a feedback form in terms of the solution minus the equilibrium solution. Is this control sufficient? And the answer, unfortunately, is no. Regardless of whether you want F to be finite or infinite dimensional, there's a counterexample of 1966 by Faber and Lebeau to the required unique continuation property, which I will mention in a little while, needed to feedback stabilize the finite dimensional projection. So the Kalman condition here is not possible, does not work. And let me show what this is. So you start again with the eigen problem for the original operator, sine operator, and the adjoint. And then what in this first case, where we want to have a control just on tangential on an arbitrary portion of the boundary, what will be the controllability Kalman condition that will have to be satisfied? It is the following, namely that the rank of this matrix be full for every eigenvalue unstable. And what are the entries here? the entries are given by the normal derivative of the adjoint eigenvectors localized on this small portion of the boundary. Is this true or false? In order to show that it's true, this is equivalent to show this unique continuation problem of the corresponding elliptic version. Namely, you look at the potentially eigen problem of, I'm writing here phi rather than phi star. As I said here, it should be phi star rather than phi, because for Navier-Stokes, looking at phi or phi star, the original of the adjoint is morally the same. It's certainly not true for the Businesque, by the way. And so the problem becomes, look at the eigenfunction, let's say for phi star, but let me call it phi, because otherwise this operator becomes more complicated to write down, divergence free. And then you have two overdetermined conditions on the boundary, namely the Dirichlet, the Neumann trace on this small little portion of the boundary is zero. And the question becomes, so there is overdetermination. The question becomes, does this overdetermination, is this overdetermination sufficient to imply the solution is phi on the entire domain? And the answer is false. Due to this Fabre-Lebeau result, even when this element Li, which is the Ossian perturbation is zero. So that doesn't work, you cannot do it. So you need to do something more in addition to this tangential control V. So what is the next attempt? The next attempt comes from a strategy that was proposed in Nolin and Nazi's paper in 2015 by Ren and myself. And we want to preserve the control V in red here, acting tangentially on an arbitrary small portion of the boundary. We know that this is not enough by itself, so we have to do something else. So we put a pair with the corresponding U now, which is obtained in the following way. You take an arbitrary small patch, interior patch, little omega, subtended by gamma tilde, and then you look at the tangential surfaces here, and you want the control to be, yes, interior, but acting tangential-like in this little omega. So this is a pair that we want to look at. And what is the corresponding controllability metric or condition, Kalman controllability in this case, which is, as I said, is the starting point for the analysis to proceed. Is the key, the starting key for the car to get started. So now the matrix is consists of two parts. Is the one which was before, which was due to the V tangential acting on gamma tilde, is now supplemented, is augmented by this portion on the right, which is given now by the eigenvectors in the tangential director and localized in the little omega. So the question is, can we find boundary vectors on gamma tilde and the interior vector in little omega such that the rank of this matrix is Li? And so the answer is, as we know, and we've seen also in the interior, that's why I showed the interior, is due to an overdetermined elliptic problem. And what is the overdetermined elliptic problem? Is the following. So you look at the problem that we had before in black, only with the V on the boundary. But now, because of this interior acting tangential-like, there's an extra condition written in red here, which is the solution, again, should be phi star rather than phi, but they are morally equivalent. The solution is also as the extra condition to be in the tangential direction equal to zero in little omega. And the question becomes, as before, this overdetermined problem, that this imply that the solution is zero on big omega? And the answer is yes. So by using this pair, it's possible to get in a Kalman condition, therefore to stabilize the finite dimensional unstable component, and therefore to get the problem started. So what were the results of the paper, which was using optimal control, is the following. If we find out that the sought after tangential boundary feedback control V of the pair, V acting on gamma tilde arbitrary small and little u acting in the interior in little omega, but in the tangential direction, is finite dimensional in two cases. When the dimension is two, and when the dimension is three, but under the additional condition, that the initial condition are compactly supported. So, finite dimensionality, by the way, of the interior control U is not a problem. The problem is for V on the boundary. The approach in the paper was again based on optimal control with appropriate Sobolev-Hilbert setting and using algebraic Riccati operator, etc. So what was the obstruction that in dimension three did not allow to get finite dimensionality in full generality? So what was the obstruction to obtain finite dimensionality in full generality of the tangential control V of the pair V acting on gamma tilde arbitrary small and U acting in the interior little omega, but in the tangential direction? The answer is the following, that in the Hilbert space, Sobolev space setting, where the problem of boundary stabilization was studied in this nonlinear analysis paper, the handling of the Navier-Stokes nonlinearity, which I mentioned at the very beginning, you know, y dot gradient of y, forced the necessity in dimension three to work on the space above h one half on omega. And for this reason, the compatibility condition kicked in. And therefore, in fact, had exactly the compatibility condition that forced the initial condition to be compactly supported. In fact, the paper found that, you know, the uniform stabilization in a constructive way consisting of two components. One component, which is finite dimensional, and the other component is infinite dimensional and becomes zero if the initial condition are vanishing on the boundary. So what is the remedy? The remedy, therefore, is to work with a function space which does not recognize compatibility condition. So the third attempt is exactly in this archive problem, the new paper, which is was just published recently in the dimension three. And it is the following. We seek to work in a function setting. So first of all, we have to abandon entirely the Hilbert setting, the Sobolev-Hilbert setting. And we want to seek a function space setting which balances for dimension three, two competing features. Namely, on the one hand, has to be topologically or sufficiently low regularity that does not recognize the boundary condition. But on the other hand, has to be sufficiently high topologically in order to handle, to accommodate the analysis of the Navier-Stokes nonlinearity for D equal three. And what is the paper? Before I show what the space is, let me introduce now this famous Helmholtz-Leroux decomposition. So as I said, the Navier-Stokes is also the gradient of the pressure. You want to get rid of that. And so there is a famous decomposition. If you're German, you call it Helmholtz. If you're French, you call it Leray. And is based on the following thing. You take it essentially for an arbitrary domain, except some pathology, which are, may not be considered here, but for bounded domain of very, very general, you can take the space LQ and you can decompose the direct sum into subspaces. One LQ solenoidal and the G, which is gradient field. The LQ solenoidal is given by all elements in LQ, divergence zero in the sense of distribution, and G on the boundary is tangential, so is orthogonal to the normal derivative. And for instance, the domain may be Lipschitz domain, it's very, very general. There are some counterexample though. For Q equal two is always true, but for Q different from two, there are some counterexample, but very pathological. G instead is a component of gradient field. So anything in G is an element which is a gradient of something with sufficient regularity. And the picture is here. So LQ is the composite direct sum of a solenoidal component and the gradient component. So if you take the corresponding projection here, you apply it to the Navier-Stokes, which is gradient of the pressure, boom, the pressure disappears. Okay, now I can introduce the functional setting. And it is a Besov setting. And was first introduced actually in this AMO paper with Budik and Irena, looking at the interior. We were not so courageous to do the boundary in one shot. So first we did the interior to analyze the difficulty and the technicality. And then once you master those, you go from the interior, arbitrary small interior to the boundary. The setting is the following. Perhaps one should start from here. This is the real interpolation space between LQ and the W, this usual W Sobolev space with the M derivative. If you specialize to M equal two and S equal two minus two Q, you end up with this space here, with these indices. And It turns out that for dimension three, the space that does the job is the subspace, so the intersection of this Bessel space with the solenoidal component, where the indices are very, very tight. P is constrained between 1 and 6/5 for dimension three, and between 1 and 4/3 for dimension two. And Q is greater than the dimension. So here I'm talking about dimension three, so Q greater than three. So this is the right space. Notice here that the space, which is the space eventually of stabilization, is, let's try to analyze the space a little bit. First of all, this G dot nu is an intrinsic condition of the solenoidal component. So it's not an extra boundary condition. In terms of regularity, because if you go back to the, here it is, the solenoidal component has this condition, the G is tangential. In terms of regularity, so P is close to one. So if you take here P close to one, this index is close to zero. So this is close to this the space here, Q. Q is greater than three. So this space is really at the level of L3. And what is very, very important in the analysis is this slide here. If you take the Stokes operator, which is part of the steady state, maybe Stokes, if you take the interpolation space between the solenoidal component and the domain of the Stokes operator, according to the range of the indices, you get either the top line or the bottom line. The top line has the condition the G is in this Sobolev, is in this Bessel space, divergent zero, but there's also G equal to zero. This is precisely a compatibility condition that we do not want. So this is not good. Then we look at the other range for P between 1 and 2Q to Q minus one. So for dimension three, this becomes 6/5. And then in this case though, this interpolation space is exactly what we want. Namely, this condition here becomes tangential on the boundary, which is part of the interpolation, the solenoidal component of the space. So this is exactly the space B tilde of the subspace of the Bessel space that we want to work with. So this is the space of close to L3, so low regularity, for which we want to do stabilization. Okay, so as I said before, Q is greater than the dimension because of an embedded that is needed in the dimensional, etc. So now we want to do the analytic implementation of the pair in the feedback form. So again, V is tangential vector on an arbitrary small portion of the boundary. You take a little interior omega, arbitrary small, supported by gamma tilde, and you take an interior in this little omega, but in the tangential direction. And U equals zero is not enough. So here, for the first time, I write down the Navier-Stokes equation with the famous nonlinearity here under the action of the control. This is the control on the boundary, which we want to be tangential, localized on gamma tilde. And this is a control in the interior, acting in the tangential direction with the characteristic function. And what we do, what is the first step? The first step, more or less standard, you introduce a new variable. So you translate the problem from the original variable, y and pressure, velocity field and pressure, by the equilibrium pair. And you get z as a new variable. And in the variable z, what is the corresponding equation? Is a Navier-Stokes equation, so with the nonlinearity given here. Well, the difference is that the forcing term disappears, and that's good. But the price you pay is that you get in a first order perturbation, which is a first order here, LE, the Ossian perturbation. And then everything else is z equals zero, and then v on the bound, z on the bound is v. For this problem, you want to find null controllability because we want to find controllability of y in the vicinity of y sub e. So here we want to have a null stabilization for z. So to do that, as I said before in the general strategy, you throw away the nonlinearity and you look first at the linearized version. So the linearized version is given a new name, a w. Okay, so there's no linearity here. you have the control on the boundary V and the interior U. And what you want to do, there are some additional difficulty in a variety of difficulty in stabilizing this issue. We need to assert that the feedback linearized problem, because W here, V is going to be expressed in terms of the feedback. So is not zero boundary, okay? It's a feedback boundary. So we want to show that this linearized feedback boundary W problem with a finite dimensional feedback control acting on the solution, not only generate a strongly continuous analytic semigroup in a Q and hints on this Bessel space, therefore preserving parabolicity, but moreover enjoys the so-called maximal LP regularity up to t equal infinity. I will explain for those who are not familiar with this in a second what this means. In the Hilbert setting for the space variable, maximal regularity has been known for many years to be equivalent to analyticity of the underlying semigroup. And this is the result of a paper of my countryman, De Simone, in Italian. I never met him, you know, I was still, I think, in school at the time, in 1964. I read this paper when I was at the University of Florida in the 80s. It's a remarkable paper using singular integrals, and he showed this equivalence. However, in a Banach LQ setting, Q different from two, maximal regularity implies, but is not necessarily implied by analyticity. So you have to establish, it's an extra thing you have to establish. So we must establish maximal regularity, and we want to establish up to t equal infinity. That's why the stabilization comes into picture. In particular, and this is the novelty, we want to do this for a problem which is not zero on the boundary. But on the boundary is a feedback problem, as I mentioned before. This V is on the boundary, is going to be a feedback of W. Now, just to give some insight, you know, the story about the issue of a maximum regularity is an issue that has been studied, I think, to be honest, mostly in the mathematical community in Europe, Germany and in Italy, and less, but to a certain degree, at the University of Missouri, for instance, in US. But was done over a zero boundary condition, okay? This is not the case here. So the nonlinear, why is important to have maximum regularity? Because the nonlinear analysis, normally local well-posedness and local uniform stabilization for the full nonlinear Navier-Stokes dimension three, is based critically in our paper here on maximal LP regularity of the linearized problem up to t equal infinity. And this is a novel treatment with respect to the past treatment that we had also in our own previous paper in the Hilbert setting. There is an advantage of having maximum regularity. I will not say a word regarding the analysis of the nonlinear because it's too complicated. So let me tell you, say what maximum regularity means, since this is a conference on operator theory. You start with the Banach space and you call minus A the generator of a strongly continuous semigroup. And you look at the corresponding Cauchy problem, yt plus ay equal to f, and the initial condition is zero. You take the forcing term f to be LP in time and with value in y for p between zero and infinity. You say that this is the definition, by the way, this was introduced by the Prato Griswold in the 60s. It's a very long story. So A enjoys the LP maximal regularity in case y sub t and a y have the same regularity as f. So there's no cancellation. And what is the regularity of f is the one given here. So if you look at the solution expressed by variation parameter formula with the semigroup here, you want this operator to be bounded by from LP zero t in time with value y to LP zero t in time with value in domain of a. So when you apply a here, you get exactly what you want. And as a result of which you get the solution is LP with value in domain of A in the space. And the first derivative, so it's a first derivative is also LP. Now, as I said before, in the Hilbert space, the maximum regularity is the same as analytic semigroup, but in general Banach space, is not equivalent. By the way, if you want to enjoy yourself, for what I know, up to a couple of years ago, there are still no explicit counterexample The counter example are indirect. So it's not an easy problem. Okay, result for dimension D equal to 3. Now is the 12:51. I have approximately 10 minutes, 5 minutes actually. So well-posedness and uniform stabilization. So here's the theorem for dimension D, dimension omega equal to 3. So start with P between 1 and 6 over 5, as I mentioned before, and take Q greater than 3, and I explained before why. And look at the original Navier-Stokes Y problem, and let Y sub E be equilibrium, be the equilibrium solution of the steady state problem, which we assume to be unstable for the problem to make sense. Then for rho positive, define the ball in the space of this Bessel space, B2 minus 2P Q comma P with these indices. So this ball is the totality of initial condition whose distance from the equilibrium in this norm for the equilibrium solution is less than rho. Then for rho sufficiently small, the results are local. You get there exists a bounded finite dimensional operator, which will be given in explicit form in the next slides. F that goes from the interior to the boundary, G that goes from the interior to the interior, or the following form, exactly what we want. V is on the boundary in a feedback form, so depends on Y minus equilibrium solution. You construct, the proof is constructive. You construct boundary vectors FK of this regularity, tangential on the boundary, and you construct a vector PK on this finite dimensional subspace. Pn is the projection that we introduced before. And of dimension k, we want finite dimension. The dimension is k. What is k? K is the best, the optimal number, namely the sup of the geometric multiplicity of the distinct unstable eigenvalues. And correspondingly, the u, which is in the interior, acting tangentially, as a form given here, again, the finite dimensionality for u is never a problem. And you construct the UK supported a little omega, and you construct a vector QK in this subspace, such that when you introduce these operators on the Navier-Stokes, so this on the boundary and this in the interior acting tangentially with the characteristic function on the little omega, you get the following result. So well-posedness, if you start with initial condition in this small set, this problem, this feedback closed loop problem is a unique mild nonlinear semigroup solution continuous in time with value in this Bessel space. Moreover, for rho possibly a little smaller, is also exponentially stable. Namely, there exists a constant gamma tilde and a constant m gamma tilde greater than one, such that the difference in this Bessel norm between the solution and the equilibrium solution, so in the vicinity of the equilibrium solution, the solution decays exponentially with respect to the initial condition being close to the equilibrium solution. And there is a way of analyzing essentially qualitatively the relationship between this gamma tilde and the real part of the first stable eigenvalue. Now, how many minutes do I have? Do I have a few more minutes or not? Hello?
55.
Yeah, do I have a few more minutes or not? How come nobody?
Half a minute.
Half a minute, okay. I want just to show the linearization. You know, one issue that was mentioned before is maximum regularity of this nonlinear problem with the right-hand side and the boundary term here. And it's based on this abstract theorem and general differential equation. The PDE with the boundary control is given by an abstract thing. So there are some abstract assumptions which are always true in the context that we want. So they are not really assumptions; they are really properties of the problem in questions. And there's a trick in the proof which I don't have time to do. You cannot do directly; you have to do to the adjoint. But since my time is over, I would like to stop here. Okay? Thank you very much for your time. Why did you hear? I cannot hear.
Ellie, is it still muted?
Yeah, no, I don't think
so. I cannot hear.
Could you? We are not muted. Really not.
Right, are there any questions for the speaker? Well, if not, let's thank the speaker again.